I'd like to welcome everybody to another installation of Math Encounters. And my thanks go out, as always, to the Simons Foundation for sponsoring this series for more than 6 years now. But I also want to call out a special thanks to someone sitting in the front row, David Eisenbud. You may not have heard his name, but it was David's idea to have this series more than 6 years ago. He said, wouldn't it be great if there were some place where people who loved math but weren't necessarily mathematicians could gather and learn and talk together about interesting math topics. So our gratitude to David for a wonderful idea. And finally, I will introduce the introducer briefly. Geva Patz has been working with MoMath for a number of years, and if you love the exhibits here and you love when they're all working well and doing delightful things, Geva is a large part of the reason why. He's behind the scenes helping us make sure that everything works well. In fact, we have a new exhibit opening on June 22nd, Hoop Curves. On your way out, you can stop and read the blow-up of the New York Times article. It will be opening June 22nd. It's our basketball and statistics exhibit, so we hope you'll all come out and enjoy that, and Geva's been a large part of helping make that exhibit work. I also should mention that Geva was our champion this year at the MoMath Masters. That's our adult math tournament. Stiff competition, it came down to the wire, but he was triumphant in the end. And with that, I give you Geva Patz.
Thank you, Cindy. So there's a quote I enjoy, which in the usual formulation goes, the more our body of knowledge expands, the more our circle of knowledge expands, the greater the circumference of darkness around it. Now, it's the MoMath crowd, and I can already hear some of you going, okay, so the pi's cancel, and there's that two down there. So the approximate ratio of what we know to the edge of what we don't know is about pi by two. That's not the point. What I found interesting and inspiring about that quote is this idea that we keep knowing more and more. You know, we can do amazing things. We can reverse engineer the brain to the point where we can plug a camera into it that speaks the code of the brain well enough that we can have an artificial camera give blind people sight. We can send probes to our neighboring planet Mars all the way through space that are accurate, that not only get there, but are able to accurately measure micro fluctuations in the gravitational field of Mars so that we have a density map of Mars, despite the fact we've never actually been there. This is amazing, but it also feels potentially a little alarming because you start wondering, well, are we ever going to sort of run out of stuff to do? There was a lovely question at the last Q&A about, you know, is there a boundary to how far someone could run a marathon? And I hope there isn't, because then what's left to inspire marathon runners? And the same thing here. I find this quote really inspiring because it says, the more we know, the more we understand what questions to ask, the more questions we have to ask. Now, this quote's usually attributed to Einstein. I've heard it attributed to Bertrand Russell. I've heard it attributed to Richard Feynman and a host of other sort of professional clever people. So unfortunately, I can't give you with absolute certainty an attribution for that quote. And if that bothers you, then you should leave right now, because tonight's speech is very much a journey into the unknown. We're not just going to the edge of that disk of light. We're not just going to the edge where the known meets the unknown. We're going to the edge of the unknown. We're going to the very edge of darkness, which may sound like a scary thing, but you've got a really good guide to get you there. And that would be Marcus du Sautoy, who is a renowned mathematician and more. He's a professor of mathematics at the University of Oxford. He is a fellow of the Royal Society. He has an OBE. He's a fellow of the American Society, American Mathematical Society. But he's also the Simonyi Professor for the Public Understanding of Science at Oxford. And that's a post that allows him to wander far and wide through the breadth and depth of science and bring back to us amazing stories about what's going on at the very edge of science. In fact, those of you who are fortunate enough to make it to the book table fast enough to grab a copy of his new book before they all sell out tonight, we'll see that the book is actually organized by edges. There's a number of them there, and the best person to tell you about them is Marcus du Sautoy himself.
Uh, Actually, it always makes me laugh a little bit when I hear that introduction and I'm introduced as the professor for the public understanding of science, because it's such a ridiculously grand title, and people expect that I must know the whole of science, and here I am to explain it to MoMath and to Manhattan. Certainly when I took over this job a few years ago, I would get journalists just phoning me up expecting me to know the answers to almost anything. So I remember the Nobel Prize for Medicine had just been announced when I took over, and I had this journalist from the Daily Telegraph in London phone me up and said, yes, just been announced for the discovery of telomeres. Could you tell me what a telomere is? Now, I must admit that biology has never been my strong point, so I'm a little bit embarrassed to admit that I was, in fact, in front of my laptop at the time. So I quickly pulled up the Wikipedia page to telomeres and told the journalist very confidently, it's the bit at the end of the DNA which controls how long the DNA lasts. And the journalist seemed quite happy, but it made me realize that there's no way that any scientist today can be expected to know it all, because there is so much science that we do know. I mean, if you think, who was the last scientist that perhaps knew all the science that was on the books at the time? Maybe Newton? Galileo? But since Newton and Galileo, somehow science has exploded and it's become so large that no one scientist could know it all. But it set me off on this journey thinking, okay, well, obviously I can't know it all, but could we come to a point where science, where scientists know it all, where we've answered all the great unsolved problems there are about the universe? Or maybe there are some questions out there that will always be beyond the limit of science to know. So it set me off on this journey, which I've been on for the last 3 or 4 years, which culminated in the publication of this book, The Great Unknown, trying to identify whether there are questions that we might not be able to answer. I mean, surely the universe isn't set up as a kind of exercise in the philosophy of science. There must be some questions that we as humans can't answer. It'd be very anti-Copernican if actually we could answer everything. So, but what are those questions? So this is the journey I've been on, and I've divided the kind of science up into kind of 7 regions that I think, what I've called 7 edges of knowledge, which I think might have unknowables hidden inside them. So what I want to do is to take you on a journey of some of these unknowables. But I think that desire to know is really basic in us. And, you know, as already been illustrated in the introduction, the kind of things we have discovered over the last few decades is extraordinary. I just kept a little track of things that have been discovered over the last few years. For example, we've landed a spaceship the size of a washing machine on the side of a comet. It did bounce around a bit before it stabilized. We've managed to make robots that can create their own language using machine learning. We don't know what the robots are saying. We have to interact with them to learn this language. We've sequenced the DNA of a 50,000-year-old cave girl, and we're using stem cells to create artificial pancreases for diabetic patients. So it's kind of extraordinary, the pace of discovery. And I think it has fueled this expectation in the public that, yeah, maybe we might come to a point where we can answer all the big unsolved questions. And I think that desire to know is so basic in us. We just want to know the answers to these things. And I think it's driven our evolutionary development. It's the desire to know has helped us to survive in our world. Those who didn't want to know died out. And I think I rather like this quote from Aristotle's Metaphysics, which I start the book with, actually, which is his statement that everyone by nature desires to know. And I actually did a little analysis. The word to know is one of only about 100 words which have a universal translation across all languages. Even the word to eat does not easily translate across all languages. So I think that desire to know drives us as a species. But I realized it was probably a very dangerous move to stand up at any point in history and declare, this is a question we'll never be able to answer. And so I kept in mind a few stories of scientists in the past who tried to do what I'm going to try and do now, which is declare some questions as potentially unanswerable. And so one of my favorite stories is an astronomer, Auguste Comte, who in 1835 very confidently declared, we shall never be able to study by any method the chemical composition of stars. Now, that seemed a very fair comment in 1835. Even today, we have never visited a star and dug a bit of the stuff out, taken it back to the lab to see what it's made out of. And yet, some decades later, scientists were able to give a very complete analysis of what a star is made out of. Because although we have not visited a star, of course, every night the stars visit us. We look up there and the light from the star visits us, and these scientists realize that they can analyze the light and give a very complete description of what stars are made out of. So I kept this story in mind and a few others of scientists who declared we can never answer this, only to be shown so wrong. But I thought, as a mathematician, surely I should be able to use my logical skills to analyze the nature of a question and show that there's nothing that you can do to show that this has any answer. So that was my role. Is there something by the nature of the question that makes it unanswerable? Now, I'm not the first to talk about the kind of unknowables. One of our great 21st century philosophers, Donald Rumsfeld, very famously made some statements about the nature of the unknown. This was a quote he gave in response to questions about weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. And the journalists were slightly perplexed when he answered, there are no knowns. There are the things that we know that we know. It's a bit dangerous to do an American accent, I agree, in America, so if you'll bear with me. We also know that there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. Those are the ones we don't know we don't know. He got given the Foot in the Mouth Award by the Plain English Speaking Society for this very bizarre response to, are there weapons of mass destruction in Iraq? But actually, I think that was a little bit unfair, because I think it's a beautiful description of different states of knowledge. The known knowns, well, the things that we know that we know. Well, scientists love talking about those. Those are the things that we've discovered. And in a sense, my book is full of the things that we think we know, but also how knowledge changes and adapts and evolves. And we realize that our description is just an approximation of reality, or a completely different story emerges. So I think it's important, if you're going into the unknown, to understand the knowledge that we do have and why we believe that knowledge is a description of reality. The unknown unknowns. I'd love to tell you about those, but they are by their nature unknown, so I can't tell you about those. But I think these are very interesting because they're kind of the game changers. They're the things which just transform science. I would say, if you look at the end of the 19th century, people like Lord Kelvin were saying, well, we've done science, we understand it all. It's just a matter of decimal places now. How wrong he was. You know, a few decades later, suddenly you get Einstein and his generation coming along, completely transforming our view of science. So I like to call these like the black swan events. If any of you have read Taleb's book, Black Swan, he identifies these as the moments in history, transformative moments when something happens unexpected, which completely changes the game. So we love these in science because the things that were discovered in the Large Hadron Collider, well, we kind of knew they were going to be there. What we want is an unknown unknown, which is going to make us totally have to reassess what we think about the physics that describes our universe. So these are really exciting, but I can't tell you about those. What I want to go for are these known unknowns. Now, there are lots of things we don't know. We don't know what dark matter is, for example. But I want to try to identify the known unknowns that will always remain unknowable. Are there any? Or maybe we could answer all of these big questions. So I'm after these. Is there anything that will always remain unknowable? Actually, I think Donald Rumsfeld missed a category here, because there's also, what about the unknown knowns? And interestingly, as our political commentator Slavoj Žižek pointed out, these are quite important for a politician, because they're kind of like your Freudian delusions, the things you deny, but actually they're the things which drive you as a human, but you deny that you know them. I think, for example, Donald Trump has a lot of these unknown knowns, which he doesn't recognize, but are really driving his character. But I'm after these known unknowns. So can we look at science and identify any questions that will, by their nature, always be unknowable? So, as I said, I've divided the book up into seven edges. And what I'd like to do in this presentation is to take you in depth into a couple of those edges and then give you a tour around the last five. So the first edge I'm going to look at, the first edge that I consider in the book, really goes to the heart of what mathematics, my own subject, is all about. I don't know the mathematicians here have this, but when I'm at a party and somebody asks me, so what do you do? I slightly look forward and dread this question, because when I say, oh, I'm a mathematician, you can see this kind of look of horror appear on their faces, and they kind of back away, and their glass suddenly becomes very empty, and they run to the bar. But I'm very persistent, so I run after them and say, no, we actually do something really interesting. And when I talk to them, I suddenly realize what they think I'm doing is, as a research mathematician, is long division to a lot of decimal places. And you know, surely I've been put out of a job by my computer by now. But I try to explain to them that a mathematician is really a pattern searcher. We're kind of studying the science of patterns. And that ability to spot patterns has really given us the power to kind of navigate our environment and perhaps know what's going to happen next. It's our best tool of looking at the data that's gone to in the past, spot a pattern, you might know what it's going to do into the future. So it's a very powerful tool for us to survive in this world. But just how powerful is this tool of mathematics to be able to know the future? Can we genuinely know, if we have the equations and the description of the universe now, can we know what it's going to do into the future? And this is the challenge of this edge. How good a tool is mathematics to know what's going to happen next? So at the heart of this is a challenge in mathematics called chaos theory, which really challenges just how much we can know about the future. Now, on my journey to the edges of knowledge, I decided to take an object with me, which I thought would help the reader and also me to kind of navigate this unknown. So each edge, I take a physical object, which I think will kind of capture the challenge of this unknown. So when I went to the edge of kind of trying to predict the future, I thought so the ultimate symbol of kind of unpredictability and unknowability is a dice. The reason we find a dice so exciting is that when I throw it on the floor, I just don't know what it's going to land on. And so I look and I'm excited to see, well, this time I got a one. But somehow the dice is an interesting object because of its unpredictability. But just how unknowable is this? You see, Isaac Newton gave us the laws which govern how this dice falls from my hand, what happens when it impacts on the floor. He developed the idea of the calculus, which is giving us a language to navigate a world in flux. So post-Newton, scientists believe that, well, now we have the tools to be able to work out what the universe is going to do next. If you know what the universe is doing now, and you've got equations to describe its evolution, we can predict the future. So I certainly thought, I've spent many years as a mathematics undergraduate learning these tools that Newton had given us, and I thought, surely that's going to give me an edge. So I went off to Vegas and thought, right, I can use these tools to cash in on the craps table. So I went off to Vegas. Unfortunately, I lost a lot of money. But they let me keep this dice. So this is the dice that I lost a lot of money with. And somehow it's really the challenge of, well, surely I should be able to know what this is going to do next, given the tools that Newton gave us. Many scientists post-Newton really believe that we should be able to know the future. But if Newton is my hero in this desire to know what's going to happen next, my nemesis in this story is this guy here. This is Henri Poincaré, French mathematician, who at the beginning of the 20th century discovered this idea of chaos theory, which puts limits on what we can know, even if we have the equations which describe the universe. You see, our intuition was that, I can never have a complete description of the present, but I can get a very good approximation of what the present state of the universe is. Then I run the equations, and that should give me a very good approximation of the future state of the universe. Poincaré showed that that's not true, that just a very small error in the present can explode into a huge, great inaccuracy in your prediction of the future. And my favorite examples of these are very simple systems. It's not a complicated system. I mean, the universe is very complicated. But even very simple systems, which we have equations for, can be so sensitive that a small change in the starting conditions can cause a completely different outcome in the evolution of this system. So my favorite example is a pendulum. Now, a pendulum is usually so predictable, we use it to keep track of time. But this is a slightly different pendulum than you'll have on a clock. It's two pieces of metal jointed together a little bit like a leg. Now, the mathematical geometry of this is extremely straightforward. I can write down a description of that. The physics that controls how this will drop when I let it go is just simply gravity. This is practically frictionless, so very simple system, yet trying to predict the behavior of this pendulum is almost impossible. I mean, it's crazy, the sort of behavior of this thing. I mean, it's, you know, can you predict which way it's going to go next? Now, but the real challenge of chaos theory is that, so we saw one particular behavior of the pendulum. Now, I have a little mark here, and I try and replicate the behavior each time. So I'm going to try and start it off. So you remember what it just did? Yeah, good. So now, is it going to do the same thing? So, okay, that takes a little bit more time to get going. Almost went through there. But this time, it's a completely different behavior. Yet I started it in almost the same position. And this is the signature of chaos theory, that although you might have a very good approximation of how the thing's starting, that may not tell you anything about what it's going to do next. This is my favorite desktop toy, so if you'll indulge me, let's just do one more, because it's so beautiful, this thing. It's like a sort of circus performer. So there you go. I started it again quite similarly, but now did a few rotations, and now it's got into this kind of resonant mode and not really doing anything exciting at all. So another of my desktop toys, which illustrates this quite nicely, is this one here. I brought it along. I have this on my desk in my office in Oxford. It's a pendulum, again, but it's got six magnets, and the pendulum is attracted to the magnets. Now, actually, each magnet has an answer to a question over it. So it's got, like, yes, maybe, definitely, ask a friend, try again, no way. So I use this to make all my decisions in life. So, let's ask it. One of my great passions is the Riemann hypothesis, a great unsolved problem in mathematics. I would love to know whether the Riemann hypothesis is going to be solved in my lifetime. So let's set this off and see whether I'm going to be lucky and be alive when it's proved. So now I've got a little example of this. This is a slightly simpler system that we did in the lab. It's got three magnets. You've got to try and predict which magnet do you think the pendulum is going to end up at. So I'm going to set this off. So this thing is going away. It's kind of crazy. Doesn't know which way it wants to go. Is it going to be the top right-hand one? Seems to be, and then right at the last minute gets pulled into the bottom left-hand one. So this one's made up its mind. It says, try again. I don't know. Well, that does sound the Riemann hypothesis. Okay, right. Try again. Let's see. Let's set it off. Here's a little experiment I did where I did a simulation, and I started the pendulum off in the top left-hand corner, and I've colored the magnets blue, yellow, and red. The first time I set it off, the pendulum ended up at the blue magnet. Then I changed just the sixth decimal place of one of the starting coordinates, so you can barely notice that it's starting in a different position. It started off quite similarly, but then ended up at the red magnet. Then I changed a little bit again and ended up at the yellow magnet. So almost you can't tell that you've changed the starting position, yet a completely different outcome. Poincaré discovered chaos theory because he was trying to predict whether our solar system was stable or not. And he realized just with if you have three planets in there, that a very small change in the starting position of one of those planets can cause a stable system to completely fall apart. So this is a little bit like an asteroid coming in, and it's potentially going to knock out one of three planets. Now, one of those is our planet, and we would quite like to know, are we going to get knocked out, or our neighboring red planet? And it seems like that's something we'll find very difficult to know, because a very small change in the position of that asteroid could cause it to knock out a completely different planet. So this seems to be so sensitive to small changes that you cannot know which planet will be wiped out. It's saying definitely this time. Excellent. So that's good news. That I'd like to know who's going to prove it next. So good. So this is a graph, a picture, which helps you to know what this pendulum is going to do. So the way you read this picture is that if you start the pendulum over a yellow region, That means that the pendulum is going to end up at the yellow magnet. So you can see there's a large area of yellow in the top left corner. That's where the yellow magnet is. So, of course, if I start the pendulum near the yellow magnet, the other two magnets aren't strong enough to do anything. So it just wobbles and settles at the yellow magnet. And a small change in the starting position is not going to change that. So here is a region where we can know what the future has in store. There's another very knowable region. If you look at opposite that yellow region, there's another big swathe of yellow there. And if you start there and make a small change, doesn't matter. Basically, the pendulum just swings backwards and forwards and ends up again at the yellow magnet. But in those simulations I did, I started the pendulum off in the top left-hand corner. And this top left-hand corner is an example of a mathematical structure we call a fractal. In fact, there are some lovely demonstrations of fractals here in the Museum of Math. And the fractal has a quality that it has infinite complexity. So as you zoom in on this region, you might hope that suddenly it will simplify and just become a region of yellow, and then you can know where the pendulum is going to go. But as you zoom in, it just retains complexity. So you might say, OK, well, I've got to the ninth decimal place. Surely it's all gone yellow now. But no, even here, when you've zoomed in that much, you see yellow, blue, and red colours still. And you zoom in a bit more, hoping to see it just become a single colour so you know what the pendulum is going to do. Maybe I need a bit more data, a bit more decimal places. But this region tells you, it doesn't matter how far you go, there's always going to be three colours there, and a small change can shift you, even in the 50th decimal place, onto a different result for where the pendulum's going to go. So this is saying that chaos theory doesn't say that you can't know anything. We've been able to use the equations of mathematics to land a spaceship on the side of a comet. That was a region which was knowable in one of these regions which small changes didn't matter. But it's also powerful enough to tell you when you can't know things. There are regions where actually now a small change results in you having no control on what the future has in hold. And this doesn't just affect the solar system. It affects so many different things in nature that we would like to know. So the weather, very classically, is a chaotic system, which within 5 days, however much data we seem to gather, the weather seems very unpredictable beyond 5 days. Now, as well as an object on my journey to the edge of knowledge, I also took a person with me, a person who'd spent their academic life at this edge to try and see, you know, how do you deal with the unknowable of something like chaos theory? So I took a colleague of mine in Oxford. This is Bob May, who understood that these chaotic systems happen very often in biological systems. So he understood that population dynamics can be very chaotic. So a small change in the population can cause a completely different population in the next generation, the next season. Actually, I should call him Lord May, because he's now a cross-party member at the House of Lords in the UK, advising government. And I went and had lunch with him at the House of Lords to see how he was getting on, explaining the importance of chaos theory to politicians. And over lunch, he said, you know, not only in research, but in the everyday world of politics and economics, we would be better off if more people realized that simple systems do not necessarily possess simple dynamic properties. And I asked him how he was getting on teaching the MPs a bit of mathematical chaos theory. And he said, Marcus, they're mostly interested in their egos here, not in high-level mathematics. So, Bob May is now working with Andrew Haldane at the Bank of England, looking at the banking crisis of 2008 to understand that maybe the equations which control the economy have some predictable regions, the moments when people can make money out of the stock market, but maybe there are regions which then go rather fractal and chaotic, and then you know you have to have a very, very conservative investment policy, because now you're in a region where small changes could send you on a high or a massive low. So interesting that he's now applying it to economics, something, in economics we would love to know the future. Sometimes we can, but maybe it's as important to know when you cannot know. Well, I came back to my dice at the end of this edge and wondered, well, maybe the reason that I didn't win any money is because this dice is chaotic and very sensitive to small changes. But I got a little bit of a surprise. This dice is not as unknowable as you might think. I discovered a piece of research done recently by some Polish mathematicians who've analyzed using high-speed cameras and also some high-level mathematics how this dice is behaving as it hits the floor and rolls. And I'm going to show you some pictures which are rather similar to the pictures that I showed you for the pendulum with the yellow, red, and blue regions, which showed us when we could know what the dice was going to do and when not. So I'm going to color the faces of my dice with different colors, red, yellow, blue, green. And then we're going to try and work out what are the changes and parameters that help me to predict whether it lands on, say, a yellow face or a blue face. And this is the results that these Polish mathematicians discovered. So you can see in the bottom right-hand corner, we have a picture which is very fractal. It has no simplicity to it at all. As you zoom in, just seems to be very complexity of colors. Now, the graph here, what I'm doing is varying two parameters when I throw this dice. So one is the height of the dice above the craps table, and the other I'm varying is the angle at which the dice leaves my hand. So what we want to know is, does a small change in the height affect the outcome? So in this bottom right-hand corner, this is describing craps tables, which are very rigid, where the dice does not lose much energy as it cascades across the table. So this floor here is very rigid, and as I roll this thing, it bounces a lot of times before it settles. And this will be a chaotic described by this fractal picture. A small change in the angle or the height will give me a completely different answer. It's these tables here that you want to go and play on, because here we see a picture which is not fractal. The top left-hand corner is a picture where a small change in the angle or the height seems to not make much difference. You can be in that yellow region and alter the height a little bit, the angle, and still you know it's going to land on the yellow face. So what craps tables is this picture describing? Because these are the ones you want to go and play on in Vegas. Turns out that these are tables which are a little bit soggy, which where the dice loses a bit of energy as it hits the table. So what you've got to look for is a casino which is a little bit down on its heels. It hasn't renovated its craps tables recently. And then these are going to be much more knowable when you throw the dice, that a small change is not going to alter very much the behavior of the dice. And if you take anything away from this presentation, hopefully a book afterwards, but also the following fact, which is that more often than not on these tables, the height you are above the table and how the dice leaves your hand, more often than not, it lands on the face that is face down on your hand. So when you go, bet on what you can see, the opposite of what you can see on the top of the dice, because more often than not, it lands on that side. So the message of this edge was really mathematics, there are regions where we cannot know, but also regions where we can know. And that's the important thing. To know when you cannot know is as important as knowing when you can know. Now, I think it's a tradition in these encounters that I set you a little sort of challenge halfway through the presentation. So I've got a little challenge about making some predictions. A dice is pretty unpredictable, but also the toss of a coin is traditionally something which we find it very difficult to predict. We use it to decide the outcome of various things. Even the World Cup, soccer World Cup some years ago, it was a draw at the end of the final, and they didn't do penalties. They decided it on the toss of a coin. It's rather extraordinary. So here's the challenge for you. I'm going to, if you've got a coin, great, get it out of your pocket. If you haven't got a coin, MoMath are offering a cent for each of you. So put up your hand if you don't have a coin, and we will get one to you. So listen to the challenge I'm going to set you. I'm going to ask you to toss your coin 10 times. And we're going to do it's like a casino. I'm going to, so if you get three heads or three tails in a row, you're going to give me $1. But if you don't do that, I will give you $1. Okay, so you're going to play at this casino. It's a dollar for a dollar. Or are you going to go next door where, let's up the, you know, how far would you go? So the other casino is going to offer you $2 if you don't get three heads or three tails in a row in your 10 tosses. So would you go there? Or what about the casino next door, which is offering $3 if you don't get it. You've got to pay $1 to play, but if you don't get it, then they'll give you $3. Or if you get, the next one is $4 or $5. So at what point will you, so I've got this right. So you, if you get it, you give me $1. If you don't get it, I'm going to give you $5. Okay, so you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. So I want you to now, before we do our experiment, just think, okay, which of these casinos will I go to? Yes, so, yeah, so which one would you not go to? Let's say that one. So of course you're going to go to the $5 one, although even that one, you know, I presumably offered you one case. So yes. Yeah, so the challenge is, which of these would you not go to?
$1.
You think $1 not? Okay. So, but which ones of these would you? So $1. What about the $2 one? Who thinks that they would go to the $2 one? Okay. There's somebody pointing their hand there. Who thinks they'll go to the $3 one? Okay. A few more. Who thinks they'll go to the $4 one? And who thinks? Well, of course, you will all go to the $5 one. Okay, so all right. You think even the $5 one? Okay. So who's going to go to? Okay, so we'll go up. Who's going to go to the $5 one? Yeah. Who's going to go to the $6 one? Well, when are you going to flip? Okay. You want certainty. Well, on your life, I want infinite dollars. So, yeah. Okay. Let's do a little experiment now. I want you to take your coin. So I think there's a bit of uncertainty about quite what the odds are here. So start doing it and keep track of whether in your 10 trosses you got 3 heads or 3 tails in a row. So off you go.
Well, just a minute. Suppose you get 2
sets. I'm not going to pay you double. Or no, you have to pay me double. I think I'm only getting tails. I think this one's I'm a bit worried that. Oh no, there's a head. So. Who's got 3 in a row already? Wow. Has anyone not got 3 in a row? Good. Okay. Keep going. I think the challenge will be, can we get anybody who does not get 3 heads or 3 tails in a row?
Okay, I'm starting
over. Okay, has everyone done their 10 tosses? Okay, let's have hands up those people who did not get 3 heads or 3 tails, so I'm going to pay you. Okay, so we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Now, I think there are over 100 people here, but I know, I did the math, and in 100 people, if you'd done this, 82 of you would have got 3 heads or 3 tails in a row, and only 18. So actually, we've got far even less amongst you who didn't get that. So, and I think that's quite surprising. It is so high. I can still pay you $4 and expect in the long run to make money. Now, most people would probably take that bet, thinking, well, 3 heads, 3 tails, that's probably quite rare. Obviously not that rare, but I think it's quite unexpected that it's that likely that you're going to get the 3 heads or the 3 tails. And if you want to work out the probability, it's a really beautiful little bit of maths because you get a sort of Fibonacci-like explanation to help you to work out that probability. So if you think how many, if I do one toss, there are 2 possibilities and neither of them had 3 heads or 3 tails. If I do 2 tosses, there are 4 possible outcomes and both of those still don't have 3 heads, 3 tails. But if I now do 3 tosses, 2 of those are things where I pay out 3 heads or 3 tails, and there are 6 where I don't pay out. So that's actually the Fibonacci rule. I add 2 plus 4, I get 6. And if you want to work out the number of times in the next toss, or with 4 tosses, that you'll not get 3 heads, or you'll get 3 heads or 3 tails, not get three heads or three tails. It's this Fibonacci rule which tells you. So if you'd like to find out a little bit more, one of the other books I wrote has the story of how Fibonacci-like rules can help you to know something. So this is the Number Mysteries book, which talks about even though the dice is and the coin is potentially unknowable, we can, over the long run, know quite a lot about the behavior of this coin. Actually, even the coin has been analyzed, and it's been shown that there's a slight gyroscopic effect that happens when it goes up in the air because there's a slight difference in weight on each side, which gives a slight edge, again, to the face that's down on your thumb being the one that turns up when you actually do the toss. It's so small that it's not really worth betting on in a casino, but it's interesting, again, that there is a little bit of a bias. So that was the edge of chaos theory. I'm going to take you into another edge, which actually says that the unpredictability of the dice is at the heart of the way we must do science, because the that edge was under the whole conditions that the universe is deterministic. That once you know the setup and you run the equations, you can know the future. But physics in the 20th century challenged that idea and says that unknowability is at the heart of the way we must do science. And this is the message of quantum physics, that quantum physics says that physics by its nature has unknowability at its heart. Now, the object I took with me on my journey to the edge of the quantum world to kind of tease out how unknowable is physics is this little pot of uranium that I bought on the internet. It's amazing what you can buy on the internet these days. And so I bought this on Amazon, and I was very pleased with it, and I thought about writing a review, actually. You know you can write those little reviews. And I looked at the reviews that had already been written there, and there was one wonderful review. This guy had given it a 5-star, was really pleased with it, and said, I'm so glad I don't have to buy this from Libyans in the parking lot in the mall anymore. It was very sweet. But there was one guy who was completely dissatisfied with this, gave it a 1-star, and said, I've had this for several million years, and it's half empty. Oh, you got the half-life joke. Great, excellent. Now, for me, the interesting thing about this pot is the number on the side, because it says 984 counts per minute. What this is telling me that is over a minute, there will be 900... Ooh, probably shouldn't do that. It's amazing what you can get through airport security as well, I must say. Blow up Manhattan. No, this is not weapons-grade uranium, so don't worry about this. In fact, a bunch of bananas is radiating more than this little piece of uranium in here. But this number is telling me over a minute there will be 984 bits of radiation kicked off this uranium. But what this little pot can't tell me, and what it seems like physics can't tell me, is when it's going to do that. This is on average, but there seems to be no known mechanism to tell me when it's going to do that radiation. And quantum physics says that is an unknowable. We cannot know when it's going to do that. And the explanation helps us to understand this is probably something you've heard of, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle articulates in a mathematical formula what we cannot know about our universe. This is an equation. If you're trying to do Newtonian physics, for example, and I've got an electron flying through the air, I want to know where the electron is and how it's moving. Then I can make a prediction of how it's going to evolve into the future. Heisenberg says, you can't know those two things simultaneously. You actually cannot get the information to apply Newton's ideas. And this is captured in this mathematical formula. It's not some wishy-washy statement. It's a very precise formula which emerges from the mathematics of quantum physics. So it says the more that you know about the position of this electron, the more uncertainty, the range of possibilities for the momentum increases. And then you might say, well, I know where the electron is, so now I'm going to measure its momentum. But the more you know about the momentum, suddenly there's an uncertainty in the position of the electron. It can suddenly be in different places from where you're expecting it to be. And this formula articulates this. Delta X is getting more and more precision in the error in where you think the electron is. As that gets smaller, to make this equation balance out, the error in the momentum has got to get bigger. And you try and get the momentum error smaller, the error in the position also gets bigger. So here's a little test so you understand Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. This is my favorite physics joke. So Heisenberg is bombing down the motorway in his BMW, and a policeman comes over, pulls him over, gets him out of the car, and says, sir, do you know how fast you are going? And Heisenberg goes, no, but I know exactly where I was. Okay, a few titters there, but that was a bit weak. Okay, so, yeah, there are people saying, why is that funny? I know you shouldn't have to explain a joke, but the reason that was funny is because Heisenberg knew exactly where he was, he had no knowledge of his momentum, his speed. He couldn't know. It could be a whole range of different values. Okay, so here's the follow-up, so you get a few more of you laughing. So the police officer says to Heisenberg, well, you were going 200 kilometers per hour. And Heisenberg goes, oh, now we're lost. Yeah, that's a bit better. Good. Okay, so now the point is that now we know about the position, the momentum. He's lost knowledge about position, and so they could be anywhere in the universe. There's a follow-up if you want to ask me in the Q&A. Schrodinger happens to be in the back of the car. We'll come to that a little later. Some have said that so one interpretation of quantum physics is that this electron does not have a position and momentum until you observe it. In fact, its position, for example, is kind of unknown, and it could be anywhere in the universe, and we have this thing called a probabilistic wave function, which says, well, what is the probability that you're going to find the electron in this particular place in the universe when I observe it? And so if the wave is very high, it's kind of saying, well, I'm very likely to find it here, but if it's low, it says, not very likely to find it here. But for me, the challenge about this whole theory is that every time you run this experiment, you might have run it once and you think, well, I know where it is. But you run the same experiment again, and it can be somewhere else. It seems it's not determined by the setup. It seems to be genuinely random. This seems to be the one thing in our universe which might possibly be random. But is that really true? Is it really true that we can't know when this the radiation is going to get kicked off this. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle kind of explains this radiation, because we know a lot about the bound state of the nucleus of the uranium. So we know something about the momentum of the particles inside the nucleus, which means we have uncertainty in the position. And that causes something called tunneling. So suddenly the position, we thought it was inside, but sometimes, randomly, it can be outside. And that's the radiation. But is that really true? Is this truly something unknowable about our universe? Or might there be a kind of little mechanism that we don't know about that is determining when it's going to do that? Now, I'm a kind of believer that this is not going to be an unknowable, that it's always going to be there. It's very much at the heart of how we do physics at the moment, but I don't think this is going to be where we'll end up. And I'm not the only one to believe this. Einstein also believed that there was something rather fishy about this kind of randomness. And he very famously wrote, quantum mechanics is very impressive, but an inner voice tells me that it is not yet the real thing. The theory produces a good deal. And it certainly does. It's one of the most well-tested theories on the books. It gives such precise predictions about the behavior of matter that I think the quantum physics have almost given up thinking about an alternative, because why do they need it? But as Einstein said, it hardly brings us closer to the secret of the old one. I am at all events convinced that he does not play dice. So is this true? Is the universe genuinely random and there are unknowables? Or might there be a mechanism which is controlling when this thing is going to radiate? We now know that if there is something, it's a very weird mechanism. Our first intuition would be that it's something very small, localized inside the uranium. But we now know, due to ideas of entanglement, that if there is a mechanism, it's a mechanism which spreads across the whole universe. There's something on the other side of the universe can have an influence on when this thing might radiate. So it's going to be weird, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So I'm intrigued about this unknown, because it's certainly at the heart of how we do physics, but will it be there in 100 years' time? Or are we ready for an unknown unknown, a black swan, a new way of looking at physics, which will show us that, although it was a very good approximation, it isn't really the real thing? So that was a kind of whiz through a couple of the edges. Let me take you on a whistle-stop tour through the other five. What is my uranium made out of? We used to think that uranium atoms were indivisible. They were part of the periodic table. And then we discovered, no, they pull apart into electrons, protons, and neutrons. And then the proton and neutron pulled apart into quarks. We think that's the bottom layer now. But each generation thought they'd hit the bottom layer. So how can we know that it won't just pull apart again and again and again? Maybe it's turtles all the way down. So the infinitely small, can we know that we've hit the last layer? So digging inside matter, but what about the infinitely big? Our universe, is our universe infinite? Or does it somehow wrap up in some finite way? And how could we ever know that? We know, thanks to Einstein, that information travels no faster than the speed of light. The universe has been going for 13.8 billion years. That means there's a cosmic horizon surrounding us beyond which we cannot get any information. So if the universe is infinite, we have no information reaching us which will tell us this. So we are in this kind of finite bubble, rather kind of Greek model of our idea of the universe. This bubble is expanding, our knowledge, more and more stuff is coming in. You might think, well, that's great, because we're knowing more and more. But it turns out we're knowing less and less, because the accelerated expansion of the universe is pushing things over the cosmic horizon faster than it's expanding. So weirdly, we're losing information. If we were evolved at some point in the distant future to do astronomy, all of the other galaxies will have been pushed over, and our model of the universe would be that we're a single galaxy surrounded by a void, and we could not know about those other galaxies because they're beyond our cosmic horizon. So extraordinary that what we know might depend on when we were evolved into the history of the universe. We do know about these galaxies, but future generations will only know about them because they'll read them in books. So the infinite universe, is that something we'll never know? What about time? What happened before the Big Bang? That's often a question which gets asked. And mathematics kind of says, well, the Big Bang is a singularity. Singularities are moments beyond which you cannot know what's going to happen. You cannot extend your data to know beyond that. So is time before the Big Bang a no-go area, something we cannot know? Turns out there might be ways to know what happened before the Big Bang. That might not be as unknowable as we think. What about those kind of big physics ones, but what about our brain? The idea of consciousness, that's philosophers, some believe that the hard problem of consciousness, knowing whether another entity is truly having conscious experiences similar to mine. Some of you are looking a little bit tired and zombified. You know, are you really conscious inside there? I mean, I know it's late, and or maybe you send your avatars along, and you're at home enjoying the baseball or something. So how can I know whether you are really conscious inside there? If I drink too much, I have a pain in my head. But is that pain anything like your pain? We give it the same name, but how can we ever know? So many philosophers challenge whether the hard problem of consciousness may be something that science will never be able to answer because it's somehow self-contained in our own system. Now, we have this idea of homogeneity, which says that, well, you're very like me, so I believe that your experience will be quite like mine, and you will have a similar consciousness. But what about this thing we carry around in our pocket? We don't believe it's conscious at the moment, but can it get complex enough at some point that it suddenly start declaring, iPhone think, therefore iPhone am, and we have to declare it conscious. It's an important thing we need to understand. And first thought I thought was going to be very much outside my comfort zone as a mathematician. But the exciting thing was I discovered a mathematical formula by an Italian mathematician who works here in the United States in Madison, a mathematical formula which describes the complexity of a network which might make it conscious. So this is a formula that could be applied maybe to an iPhone and tell you when it actually passes a threshold we must consider it's having an internal world. So I love this, that suddenly even what makes me is a piece of mathematics. And actually, the final edge that I end with is looking at my own subject of mathematics, because mathematics has been able to turn on itself and understand that there are things in mathematics that we will never be able to prove are true. Now, the object I took with me on my journey to the edge of mathematics was rather a weird one, especially I wrote this book in the UK, and when it was published here in America a few months ago, I had to explain this thing, because apparently at Christmas in America, you don't have Christmas crackers. Now, this is part of our culture in England, these weird rituals over dinner that we have these things, you pull them apart and there's a big explosion and inside there's a joke and a little novelty toy and things. So I clearly see there's a marketing opportunity here in America that if you've missed out on these things, they're wonderful. But I'm very nerdy and I make my own mathematical crackers for my family. They despair at this, but so I put a little mathematical joke in and a little mathematical kind of toy. So they thought the jokes were very lame, but I actually, one of them I think is really funny. This is one that I got in my cracker. So Benoit B. Mandelbrot is the guy who, one of the guys who came up with the idea of fractals, these things with infinite complexity. So the joke is, Benoit B. Mandelbrot. Yeah, so what does a B stand for in Benoit B. Mandelbrot? Yeah, Benoit B. Mandelbrot, exactly. And what does that be? His name is a fractal, get that. So I thought that was quite funny, but my family thought that was pathetic. But they quite like the little, so I put a little paradox into this cracker as well, because I always loved these as a kid, these kind of linguistic paradoxes. So you have, a little card and it says, this statement is false. And you go, okay, so let's suppose that statement's true. Oh, but it says it's false, so it can't be that. So it must be false. But if it's false, that means this statement is true. And then you get into this kind of infinite regress. And so With linguistic statements, we realize that you can have these paradoxes that doesn't necessarily have to have a truth value. But in mathematics, if you've got an equation, it must be either true or false. But a logician, Kurt Gödel, realized that you could make these self-referential statements in mathematics with devastating consequences for what we can prove in mathematics. So Kurt Gödel proved something which is a kind of limitation to knowledge within my own subject of mathematics. He proved this thing called the Gödel's incompleteness theorem, which says that within any system for mathematics, there are true statements within that system which you cannot prove are true. And how did he do this? Well, he used that idea of the little paradox I had in my cracker, but instead of saying this statement is true, he wrote this statement is unprovable. But the clever thing he did was to use something we call the Gödel coding to change this statement into an equation of mathematics, which must either be true or it must be false. Now, suppose this equation is false. So what does that mean? So it means that the statement is actually provable. But provable statements are true, so we've got a contradiction again. But because this is an equation of mathematics, this equation must be either false or true. So that means it must be true. But that says there's a true statement now in mathematics. This equation is true, but when we analyze what it means, it says that this statement is unprovable. So we now have a true statement which cannot be proved true. But actually, we have proved it's true. It can't be proved true within this system. We've pulled outside the system, looked in, and proved it's true but unprovable within the system. But that new system has its own true statements which are unprovable. Now, this was quite devastating for mathematicians because I'm working on a lot of conjectures. What gets me up in the morning is the things I don't know. That's what gets me to my desk, things like the Riemann hypothesis or challenges of symmetry that I'm working on. But my great fear is about this unknown. What if the thing that I'm working on is actually something which is true but does not have a proof within the system that I'm working in? What I found when I went on this journey to the edges of knowledge and talked to many scientists would not admit that there was anything that they couldn't know. Because I think in order to be able to do science, you must go in with maybe arrogant belief or just kind of like the innocent fool. One of my favorite operas is Siegfried, part of the Ring cycle, where Siegfried is able to slay the dragon because he's not frightened of the dragon. Everyone else is frightened of that dragon. And that's why I think it's important in a way to kind of believe that in science, maybe we can know it all. Thank you.
All right, so we have time for some questions. So if you raise your hand, I'll bring the mic to you.
Hi, I would just like to comment. That's why there are more male scientists than female scientists. That
do you think that's right?
That I must be right.
Now I think that's an interesting kind of thought. I think that if you're doing biology, for example, I mean, I think I got drawn to mathematics because I also hankered after that certainty. I found biology, you have to be able to deal with the unknowable in biology because it's very messy. I think, I have a lot of respect for biologists because it's just this, it's a much more difficult than maths, I think. Because maths, there's a kind of way to work your way to that, this kind of certainty. So again, it's interesting that, is that a quality as well, that those people are able to deal with kind of uncertainty and things are drawn more to biology, whilst, I was almost slightly aspergic, and I mean, my wife definitely thinks I'm aspergic, but I think, if you look, there's quite a lot of evidence of maths departments attracting people with something like Asperger's because of wanting that, the certainty that mathematics gives you. So actually, I had Simon Baron Cohen, not Sacha Baron Cohen. No, they are related. So Simon Baron Cohen is an expert in autism and Asperger's, but he gave, and very often it's considered as as a negative thing. But he's trying to, and very often it is very incapacitating. But he's trying to spin that there is a positive side to this, and he's doing a research analysis at the moment to see whether those with Asperger's and autism are actually much more represented within the mathematical community. So I took part in a piece of research sort of which put me way high up on the Asperger's spectrum than an average male. So it's interesting that I think that there seems to be some evidence that that kind of need for, that's why social interaction is quite difficult for somebody with Asperger's or autism, because they can't deal with the unpredictability of human behavior. I think there's kind of interesting issue, many interesting issues that your statement kind of sparks. Yes?
Does your shirt have anything to do with tonight's presentation?
Very good. My shirt, I think, is quite Godillian in its statement, because how can somebody say, "I know nothing"? Because if you actually, surely you know something then, if you know nothing. So I thought it was quite nice, but I'm also a big Game of Thrones fan, so this is Jon Snow. Jon Snow's girlfriend keeps on telling him, "Jon Snow, you know nothing." But he never says himself, so I quite like the shirt. I'm a big Game of Thrones fan, and I felt it had a kind of girdle kind of nature to it as well. Yeah, good, right. Glad you got it.
Hi, can we have Schrodinger in the back seat now?
Yeah, Schrodinger in the back seat, exactly. I have to do a little setup to tell you Schrodinger's paradox about the cat, which is if an electron can be in two places at the same time, doesn't that mean a cat can be both dead and alive at the same time? Because the electron could be in one position and sets off you enclose in a box, so it's unobserved. The electron here means that a poisonous gas is released and the cat gets killed. But if the electron is here, the cat is safe. So it means before you observe this, if the electron is in both places at the same time, the cat is in two states, what we call superposition. It's both dead and alive at the same time until I observe it. Okay, so now you know enough to find the joke funny, hopefully, which is that so the police officer goes around to the back of the car, flips the boot open, goes, "Oh my gosh, you've got a dead cat in the back of your car." And Schrodinger goes, "Well, it's dead now." Okay, because he's just observing. He collapsed the weight function, I haven't said. No. Yeah, so next question.
Okay. Great presentation, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
I have a question. Like, for example, talking back in the chaos theory. So, for example, we know like these, for example, molecules, sometimes they behave like in Brownian motion.
Yeah.
And sometimes scientists are able to predict, like, just by applying, like, for, like, one dimension, like, the way that these particles behave. Can we apply the same thing to in chaos theory, for example?
Yes, your story is very interesting because it's the reason that we know that the world is not continuous, but is made out of atoms. And this is one of the stories I tell in the book about matter. You know, how do we know that that about atoms? And it's a really recent kind of revelation. It was Einstein who used this idea of the Brownian motion. So you see the molecules yes. being kicked around in a kind of random manner. And he did the maths to be able to work out what the size of these small things must be and their mass in order to be able to create the effect of the pollen, say, on the surface of the water. Yes, I mean, you will the behavior of these things as soon as you've got many particles in this system are going to probably have a chaotic nature to them. But again, we will use this is the I mean, what we did with this exercise with the coin was, although that may be very sensitive to small changes, yet in the long run, we can get some knowledge about this thing. So what we use is a statistical analysis of the behavior of the atoms in the room here. We may not know what an individual atom is doing, but it's enough to have a kind of statistical knowledge to be able to know a lot about what the behavior of a collection of atoms, say, in this room is doing. So I know that if I go into the corner, I'm not going to find a vacuum suddenly. That would be very unusual. So.
Hi, thank you for the great discussion yesterday. And
yeah, talk. Great.
So I read that Darwin once made the statement that he felt that we would not be able to know everything because the brain...
Sorry, could you just...
Darwin?
Yeah.
So he made the statement that we will not be able to know everything because the human brain did not evolve to know all these things. It basically evolved to find food and sex.
Yes, I talk about this in the book because there's clearly limitations just on capacity of what our brains can know. Our brain is a finite piece of equipment which will finite number of neurons, a lot of them, but will do a finite number of operations within a lifetime. So we can already know that one human will only know a finite number of things, and mathematics has an infinite number of true statements. And I often worry whether, say, something like the Riemann hypothesis, maybe this will be provable, but perhaps the proof has a complexity that will be beyond any human to be able to navigate. So it might have a proof, but maybe it's a capacity limitation of our brain. And so you could use that to prove there are things we won't know, but it won't tell you what they are. And so that's why I wanted to push a bit further and not just use the limitations of the capacity of the brain. But you know, here's a question that by its nature, it doesn't matter what you do, even if you had infinite capacity or something, or unlimited capacity, let's say, you still wouldn't be able to answer this. You can consider the universe as one great big computer. There's scientists have analyzed, you know, how much can the universe know at this point after 13.8 billion years? And it's still a finite amount of information. So if you consider the universe as a computer, you might ask, what's it computing? It's actually computing its own evolution, but can only know, again, a finite amount. Yes, great.
Hi.
Hello.
This is not a question. This is just a kind of personal question about your what sort of mathematical research you do and your background in math.
Yeah. I do research into something called group theory and number theory. So group theory is the study of symmetry. So it's actually the subject of my second book. We actually had, they have a wonderful book club here at the Museum of Maths, which I really encourage you to come along. And they chose quite randomly the symmetry book, which is telling the story of my own research and the larger story of symmetry. But I use tools from number theory to actually try and understand symmetry. So we try and understand prime numbers using something called a zeta function. And it's a very powerful tool to try and to navigate something which looks very random and unpredictable. And so I use a zeta function to look at possible symmetries that might exist. And very often they look very wild, but I can use this tool from number theory to give me some find some patterns and order in this kind of unpredictable mess. So so that's kind of the maths I do.
Oh, sure. No, that's okay. Excellent presentation, thank you. And I love Christmas crackers, by the way.
Oh,
I love
great. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They're
very great. Going back to the craps story that you told, because I'm a craps player. But
are you?
I was interested in finding out more about why you picked those two variables of height and angle. And why, like, the power in which you throw, especially at the table, if the table makes a difference at how hard you throw it,
yeah,
or how many times, you know, you roll it versus just kind of tossing it, and why that doesn't come into the equation.
Oh, it certainly does. I mean, but this was just to give you a two-dimensional picture. So there are many variables, but then the pictures that I wouldn't be able to show you those pictures. And I must say, this is the decisions by the Polish team. So I took this research. So it's not my own research. They've got varying different parameters. But in order to make these pictures, you really want to just fix some things and just vary two, and then you'll start to see pictures that you can sort of interpret. But you're absolutely right. There are many more variables than just the angle and the height above the table, which will impact on those. And it's interesting which of those are going to have a similar sensitivity on which ones. You know, there might be systems where actually the strength that you throw is not fractal, but the height is. Important to analyze all of these things and know which ones are you sensitive to and which are a bit more robust.
So with the understanding that Marcus will be available for questions in person afterwards, I can take one more question.
Hi, just a quick question. When you do your research and your work, I was just kind of wondering how you did it. Do you text message the entire time while you're doing math? Do you lock yourself in a cabin and isolate yourself from the rest of the world? Or do you watch the telly while you do it? I don't know.
No, I certainly don't watch the telly. The symmetry book sort of tells that story, because I keep a kind of diary of a year in my working life. And I think people just don't get, what does a mathematician do all day and how do they do it? And so for me, I use music a lot. So I'm a trumpet player and I love classical music. And I find that a very good environment. And I almost feel, you know, is it stimulating a similar sort of pattern searching side of my brain? But it also helps the anxiety of when things aren't going well, that I can allow my brain to go somewhere else, and I don't feel, I can't do this. Oh my God. So I need a safe place to kind of go to when just nothing's happening. As many mathematicians will talk about, the role of the unconscious is very important. So you will sit at your desk and you'll try and think, but very often the ideas will come when you move away from your desk and you allow the unconscious. I almost feel like my brain, you know, I set things up and it's a bit like the brain is slamming away on the piano and it's all sounding really rubbish, and then suddenly it hits a sequence of chords and you think, oh, listen, you've got to listen to this. And it throws it up into my conscious mind and suddenly says, listen to this. And then that's what we call that flash of aha! And I described one of those moments in the book, which seemed to come out of nowhere, but obviously it didn't. I had set up, with a lot of hard work, this kind of unconscious piano player who's then suddenly found a sequence of chords which my brain told me I needed to be conscious about.
Wonderful. All right, let's give one round of applause for Marcus.